Jesus, work in the rain, spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
Man, I'm glad you're here. Yes, sir. I tell you what, it's going to be a good night. We got Rusty Vineyard in the house. That's always a good thing. We love to have Rusty. We got good folks here from all over. It's good to see some of you back. And anybody who's here for the first time, we're glad you're here. Appreciate y'all being here. Well, let me ask you a question. Are you expecting? Amen. Well, I believe that makes a big difference. If we can have a expectant heart ready to receive, then God's got something to work with. And so, you know, that's a big part of it. Well, tonight as we get ready to start, I don't know, did we ask anybody to pray? Okay, so I'm going to do it. Or you got a microphone right there. Well, let's open in a word of prayer.
It was a test. Okay, now we're ready. Heavenly Father, we just open up our hearts to you tonight, Lord. We open up this place to you and we invite you in, Lord. We just pray a blessing over Kelly as he delivers a message and Rusty as he delivers in song. Lord, I pray that people leave here better than they came in and that they carry it outside the four walls, Lord. I bless those watching online and I pray that they find their way into the church here, Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Well, you know, one of the things that we, you know, are blessed with is always good music, good singers, and of course, Rusty Vineyard has been here for a long time. Most of you know him, but those that are newer might not. He comes from Guthrie, has ministered, ministers and quite a bit around, and now even more because he's semi-retired or retired or this is all he does. So that makes you a professional. And anyway, he is, and we're very blessed to have him. So let's give Rusty a hand. You're doing well.
Well, I told some folks today that I am going to a place that I love to go. I love to be here. If y'all don't ever catch on to that. The other thing I love to do is sing about Jesus. So I'm thankful to get to do that. I thought I'd pull out an old cowboy song. Yeah, it's right there. I'll get rid of it. Cowpoke went riding that one dark and windy day. Up on a ridge he rested as he rode along his way. And all at once a mighty herd of red-eyed cows he saw flying through the ragged sky and up the cloudy draw. Their brands were still on fire and their hoofs were made of steel. Their horns as black and shiny, and their hot breath he could feel. A bolt of fear went through him as they thundered through the sky. He saw the riders coming hard, and he heard their mournful cry. Yippee-yay-ho! Yippee-yay-ho! ghost riders in the sky. Their faces gaunt, their eyes are blurred, their shirts all soaked with sweat. They're riding hard to catch that herd, but they ain't caught them yet. They gotta ride forever in that range up in the sky. Horses snorting fire as they ride on, hear their cry. Yippee-yi-yo. Ghost riders in the sky. As the riders loped on by him, he heard one call his name. Say you want to save your soul from hell riding on our range, then cowboy, change your way. Today you're with us, you will ride, trying to catch the devil's herd across these endless skies. Yippee-yi-yo. Yippee-yi-yo. Ghost riders in the sky. In the sky. Thank you. How many of you had ever had a really, I got a saddle I could ride in for a week. Of course, it takes a good horse, too. That helps a little bit, too. But that good saddle will help even kind of that little rough horse sometimes. Ever had a good saddle and you sold it? Anybody? Oh, it helped you get through college? Well, but you still wish you had that saddle. Okay. That's what this song's about. Daddy should have been a preacher, man, cause everybody loved to hear him speak. He never followed his own advice, but we got a sermon every week. He said trouble always starts as fun, and broken hearts will always mend. Tough times don't last, tough people do. Nothing breaks if it can bend. Never sell your saddle, never owe another man. Watch where you spit on a windy day. Don't use words you don't understand. Find the Lord before you need him, and never lose your pride. Don't ever sell your saddle, 'cause life's a long, long ride. Daddy never ran from anything, always took the share of the blame. Had a heart big enough to fill a valley up, but it was hard enough to stop a train. He'd say only fight when you have to, 'cause there's always a faster gun. You'll know a hero from a coward when you see which way they run. Don't ever sell your saddle, never owe another man. Watch where you spit on a windy day. Don't use words you don't understand. Find the Lord before you need him. He's waiting by your side. Don't ever sell your saddle, 'cause life's a long, long ride. Daddy left me his old saddle the day that he passed on. And I remember all the words, he said, just like they were in stone. Don't ever sell your saddle, never owe another man. Watch where you spit on a windy day. Don't use words you don't understand. Find the Lord before you need him. He's waiting by your side. Don't ever sell your saddle, 'cause life's a long, long ride. Don't ever sell your saddle, 'cause life's a long, long ride.
All right. Well, let's turn to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel is a book in the Old Testament. If you're wondering where Daniel is, if you're not as familiar or not as easy, it's not one that you go to a lot, but it's later after some of the bigger books. But Daniel chapter 3. Daniel's an interesting book. It's one that you've probably heard this. You will have heard this story You will, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you know, we probably have heard that story, the three Hebrews that were in exile at that time. And that's what happened in this story, is that the people of Israel had gotten taken over by Babylon, and Nebuchadnezzar was a king. But he chose some of the better Jewish men, or the Hebrew men, and to come and to serve in the palace and to serve in different areas and different ways. And there was a reason that Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were chosen. They were chosen because, first of all, they honored God. It talks about that in the first couple of chapters, how they chose to pray, to seek God, to honor God. They were going to live for God. And because of that, that caused them to have favor with the Pharaoh and the leaders. God recognized, or because of God in them, they got recognized for the attributes that they had. And so they were put in positions of authority, put in positions of responsibility. And one of the things that God did with Daniel, and we're not going to read a lot about Daniel today, but Daniel could read or could interpret dreams. And so the king had this dream, and none of his magicians and his wise men and all the people that he used couldn't define or tell him what this dream was. But Daniel came in and gave him what the dream was. Now, part of what that dream was is a structure, or a monument, or this big golden thing, like similar to what he has made. So that was in chapter 1 and 2, or chapter 2 mainly. But chapter 3, let's look at this. He says, then King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 60 cubits high, which is 90 feet, 6 cubits wide, which is about 9 feet, and it's set up on the plain of Duran, and in the providence of Babylon. So he sets this up, and most of you may, if you grew up in church at least, you know the story, that when the music sounded, everyone was commanded to bow down and worship. Well, there were people from all different backgrounds. Babylon at that time was the power. They had overthrown a lot of different countries, or were in control of a lot of territory, and so there were people from all different backgrounds. It wasn't that great of a deal to all those that weren't that weren't Israeli or weren't Hebrews, because they knew there was only one God. Most everybody else, they worshipped all kinds of things. I mean, you know, sun, moon, stars. You know, I don't know. They cattle, the animal. They worshipped all kinds of things. So it wasn't out of character for them to fall on their face and worship this golden image. But for Daniel, for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that was a no-no. They knew that the commandments of God was, you put no other God before me. You worship God and God alone. And it wasn't just in lip service to them. It wasn't just a religious thing to them. They had chosen, I'm going to live for God. Now, the title of this message is Jesus is Always There. And, you know, I started to go to New Testament scriptures. I started to go to several different places. But I thought we would start here and read this account of how God delivered them. Now, the music played and everybody fell down but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Well, the guys that were in power there, under them, they had been put in a position of responsibility over a lot of different people. And, you know, it's interesting, they didn't like that. Imagine that these Babylonian people, these people that had already had their position in place, God's favor had elevated Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego above them and kind of made them mad. So they set up this plan, this strategy to get them in trouble. So in let's go to verse 8. Let's read verse 4, actually. It says, "Then the herald loudly proclaimed, 'Nations and peoples of every language, this is what you are commanded to do, that as soon as you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of God that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace.'" So it wasn't like you're going to get a slap on the wrist. It wasn't going to be you're going to get reprimanded. It wasn't going to get you're going to get 3 days in jail. It was you're going to die. And you're going to die a not very happy, wonderful death. You're going to be thrown in a fiery furnace. And so it was a very serious thing. Now, in verse 12, it says, "But there are some Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, your majesty. They neither serve your gods, nor they worship the image of gold that you have set up." Now, I want to emphasize something that stood out to me in this verse. So after they didn't do what they were said they're going to do, and I'm trying not to read the whole thing. That's why I'm jumping around a little bit. But here's the thing. They chose to bring that before the king. They said, "These guys are not bowing down." But the way they made the statement, they taught in a half-truth. See, this sounds like tactics of certain people in northeast of here, you know, certain people in other places, certain people that could be in the media. I'm just saying, just using an example. But here's a half-truth. Notice it says they pay no attention to you. That's not true. Now, what they said after that was, "Your majesty, they neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up." Now, that part was true. So they made a false statement followed by a true statement. So they mixed truth and a lie in order to deceive or to paint the image to get the perception from the king to get what they wanted. You know, this is a tactic of the enemy, to use a half-truth, use a partial truth. What did the devil would even try to deceive Jesus or try to tempt Jesus to try to get him to give up what he was there for, to try to get power over Jesus? But he said, they said that he paid no attention to him. But yet, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had been honoring the king's requests. They'd been causing the kingdom to be very well run. They were doing their job well, respecting the king, doing very well. But these people painted the image that gave the half-truth. Said, they pay no attention to you. Well, no, they paid attention to him, and I wrote this down. They paid attention to him until honoring the king meant dishonoring God. Now, see, they had to come to a place, a very serious decision point, of making a choice that says, "I'm going to trust God even if it cost me my life." Now, I can just tell you that whenever you make a decision to serve God, we're not quite yet at a place that we're have to worry about this. But there's places in the world they already do. There's places in the world where Christians are tortured, or killed, imprisoned. There's places in the world that are like that. You know, it's interesting that we already begin to see them. They'll cut off our Facebook, or they'll interrupt our live feed. They'll do there's things that are beginning to happen. That's why we've set up the website. That's why we want to get it to the point where the people that are watching online don't have to use platform. You messing with me or is that? Nope, you didn't do it. He says, I'm innocent. But see, there is a real force out there. Now, see, we have to have it settled. This is the way I'm going to live. This is what I'm going to choose to do. Regardless if, what's the song say? Though none go with me, what is the rest of that? Still I will follow. See, no turning back, no turning back. See, Shadrach and Meshach, this is an extreme condition. I realize that. But here's the thing. What if we choose to not only live for God, give Him our life, but we choose that we're going to trust God in what He says? We're going to follow Him regardless of what the circumstances say. My morning Bible study, we're talking about James chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, where it says, do not doubt. Ask in faith for wisdom. Ask in faith and then don't doubt. Well, listen, there's going to be times doubt comes. That's a reality. But that doesn't mean that we don't choose to go back to or that it's not important that we don't go back to what God has said in the first place. See, in our relationship with the Lord, we have to be so convinced that no matter how much other evidence comes, we're not turning. You know, it's kind of like I heard the illustration, I've used it before, but if you're swimming in the pool, doing a backstroke, somebody comes up beside you and says, there's no water in that pool. Are you going to go, oh, man? No, you're going to laugh at them, right? See, that ought to be our approach when people say something that's contrary to what God has already promised us. When we make Jesus Lord of our life, when we surrender our life to Him, we're not always going to feel saved. You ever notice that? Sometimes we don't feel saved. I told the staff, we were the guys that are helping, and not everybody was there, but the ones that I had handy, I pulled them in there, and the Lord gave me this word this afternoon, just talking about how we have to have it settled in our minds that this is the way we're going to do. We got to be vigilant against our adversary, the devil, and his tactics to drag us down any way we can. See, just like I said, we're going to stand against the COVID. All that information coming back around, some of you went, what? Because you shut the news off. Well, see, I watched just enough to get me a little bit of information. But you know what? Here's the thing. We got to stay hooked into the Word. No, God, I'm going to trust You. And see, they had that already settled before the music. You know, when that proclamation came out, they didn't look at each other and go, well, are we going to bow or not? Well, they might have had that conversation, but in their heart of hearts, they'd already had it settled. We're standing. In their heart of hearts, they said, we've already made our decision. You know, somebody coming along trying to say that God doesn't save or that Jesus is not the only way. To you who've already made that decision, walked that walk, living that life, you shouldn't ever be able to be talked out of it. Well, you know, there's other areas of our life that we can do that same thing in that trusting of God. But let's go on with this story. It says, verse 13, furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods and worship the image of gold that I have set up? Now, when you hear the sound of the horns, flutes, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music, if you're ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? He sounded like a pretty confident dude. He says, then what God? What God's going to save you then? See, he tried to elevate himself. But notice how they responded. Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. In other words, it's already settled. We already know what our response is. If we're thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And he will deliver us from your hand, Majesty's, or from your Majesty's hand. You know, they already determined, predetermined how it's going to be. You know, they settled with in their heart, in their mind. They said, the God we serve is able. That's why I challenge you with that thought and that question every week. Are you expecting? Are you going to see God show up to do something? Do you believe that God is able? You know, in my morning Bible study, when I'm talking about not doubting, that's one of the things that we got to get settled in our mind. God, what are you able to do? Now, here's a thought, though. A lot of times, most people wouldn't question God's ability. Isn't that probably right? I mean, you think about if you believe in God, you're believing, you know, He's the Creator. He is, you know, He is the one. He had Jesus come to this earth. We watched all that Jesus did. So His ability wouldn't be the question. But is there sometimes a question about what His ability is able to do in you? It's more about you receiving than God, His ability to get it done. And so they were already convinced He's absolutely able to deliver us. And then they followed it up, and He will. And He will. See, they had that predetermined in their mind. God, you are my source. We're going to trust you regardless of the circumstance. We know that you're able, and we know that you will do it. Deliver us. Now, notice how they worded this, though. They said, deliver us from your hand. He says, but even if He does not, sound like they can contradict themselves. We want you to know, Your Majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you've set up. You see, as they made that statement, they said, if you throw us in this blazing furnace, our God is able, and he will deliver us from your hand. See, their statement was, we're getting delivered from your hand through death or through coming through the fire. It really doesn't matter. And it doesn't change our trust in God. It doesn't change that we're settled on. We're not bowing to any other God. We're going to trust our God. We're going to see God show up in this situation. So you know what that gave them freedom from? Fear. Freedom from worrying about how it's going to happen, what's going to happen. Just trust in God. Just trust in God in the midst of it all. How are we going to do it? I don't know. We're just going to do it. How's it going to end up? I don't know, but it's going to be good because God's good. I'm going to trust Him. I don't know if we're going through the fire. I don't know if we're going to get it to go on to heaven. I don't know if we're going to get this to happen or that to happen. But you know what? They didn't want to spend any time worrying about how God was going to do it. They were just saying, look, King, we're not bowing to you, and we're going to be delivered from your hand. Now he goes on. I love this. He says in verse 19, he says, then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that their attitude had not changed. He ordered the furnace heated up seven times hotter than usual, commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie them up, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's commandment was so urgent, and the furnace so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. Oh, and then I love this part. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, weren't there three men that were tied up and thrown in there into the fire? And they replied, certainly, Your Majesty. He said, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like the Son of God. See, Jesus is always with us. Said he looks like the Son of God. We don't know if that's actually Jesus. It was an angel. It doesn't really matter. The point being, everybody knew from that moment forward that was in anywhere around that God, the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, had showed up on the scene. God had delivered him. That God hadn't left him alone. And in the midst of it, he's there with him. See, I can tell you that some of you may go through periods of time of that are dark. You may go through times that feel like a fiery furnace. There may be times where you don't know how you're going to get through. But I can tell you that in each one of those times, Jesus is there with you. God said, He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He says that over and over again. There's so many times, what did Jesus say? I'm going away, but I'm sending you another comforter. I'm going away, but I'm not leaving you orphans. Whatever we're facing, whatever we go through, all of those dark times, those challenging times, those times where there may not be another person that we can totally rely on, but there's God who we can rely on. Jesus is always with us. And you know what? Some of the times whenever we pray for things, you know, God's been in prompting me, challenging me with, and He gave it to me, I believe it was Monday in our morning Bible study, but that we have that prayer and asking for wisdom. God, how do we specifically pray? I try to pray very specific. I try to, when I'm praying for you, praying for me, praying for situations, I try to be led by the Spirit of God. That's what being led by the Spirit of God is. But I want the wisdom of God concerning my prayers so that I'm not just praying according to my will. I'm praying according to God's will. I'm lifting up that situation. You know, listen, there's times when people ask for prayer and it's really hard to know what to pray. That's our responsibility. That's your responsibility to begin to seek God and say, God, what is your wisdom concerning this? What areas of discernment do I need? How do I get discernment and wisdom on the specifics of what is happening behind the scenes and maybe underneath? What are the areas and the things that need to be addressed? With the guys up there in before, there were some things the Lord told me to be very vigilant against. God's not surprised by your circumstance, your situation. He can lead, guide, and direct you. He can give you insight into the things that you need. You know, as I get ready to wrap this up, the other there was another time in Acts chapter 27, I believe it is, that the Apostle Paul had an angel of the Lord show up. In the midst and in his situation. He was sailing on a ship. There was going to be great loss. They're in the midst of the storm. Everything is going awry. And he says in verse 22, Acts 27, verse 21, let's go with that verse. He says, after they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, men, you should have taken my advice and not sailed from Crete. He had told them not to, and anyway, they went ahead. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost, only the ship will be destroyed. Last night an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given your lives, the lives of all of you who sail with you. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as He told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island. He said, it's going to get rough. We're going to lose the ship. There's going to be some challenging times, but Jesus is with us. God is with us. The end result can be good. Sometimes what our prayer is, Lord, we don't like this circumstance or this situation, but the end result is blessing. The end result is health. The end result is peace. The end result is restoration. The end result is recovery. You know, in knowing that Jesus is with us, there's a great peace. Sometimes we don't know. Sometimes we just got to trust. Sometimes we just got to believe. Sometimes, and I can tell you this, it'll help if we get it settled beforehand. God, I don't know how this is going, but I know who's going with me, and I'm going to follow you. I'm going to trust you. Amen. Well, you know, one of the key factors in all this is that we make Jesus Christ the Lord of our lives, make Him our personal Savior. You could have gone to church for years and years. You could be watching online. You could be right here, and people assume you're saved. But until you've made that choice and that decision to say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ and to say, Jesus, I want you to be my Lord, my Savior, and I receive that free gift, you can't be confident and secure in that reality. Well, you know, tonight, as I close in prayer, I want you to ask yourself that question, am I ready? If you want to make Jesus Christ Lord of your life, if you're watching or if you're sitting here, you can pray along with me. Let's pray together. Father, we just come before you and we just thank you and praise you that Lord God, your word is forever settled in heaven, that it does not return into you void. And Lord God, I thank you that you've said, no matter what the condition of our life, you didn't say we had to get perfect first. You didn't say we had to begin to do this or that. You simply said to believe in you, to accept the free gift of salvation. To say yes to Jesus Christ is to say, Lord, I receive the salvation provided through the cross. If you'll pray this prayer, say, Dear Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I give it to you. And Lord, I believe that you were raised from the dead to give me new life. Lord Jesus, I confess you as my Lord and Savior. Come to my heart, come into my life. Make me new. Father, I praise you and I thank you that if there's those who just to themselves, just quietly there, maybe online, maybe right here, prayed that prayer, I pray, Father God, that you'd stir within them their heart to the knowing that they are now confident in being born again. And Father, I pray that you'd give them a boldness to contact me, to get to acknowledge online through the way that we can respond, and also here by contacting me. We thank you and we praise you, Father, that we can help them begin that new life in you. We praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. You know, we've had people give their hearts to the Lord right here. We've had people give their hearts to the Lord online. If you're here tonight and we're gonna dismiss for prayer, two things can happen. One, you can come up there and pray with us. We're just gonna slip into this little room right up here, and then I'll come back down. But if you want prayer for either salvation or to confirm that you made Jesus Lord, or if you would like prayer because you have a need, we'd love to lay hands on you, believe God with you, and pray for your needs to be met. So you're welcome to do that, to join us. Otherwise, we want you to spend some time enjoying Rusty. I had to think of your name for a minute. Rusty Vineyard. We're so thankful for him to be here. So let's have Rusty come back and worship a little more with us. Give him a hand. Meet me at the top if you'd like.
I understand. I think I set up where the rock was not this time. Well, I have got to spend this last week with teens, with young people, and I was kind of their music leader. And the interesting thing was it was a camp called Camp Joy. It's north of Guthrie. And their theme was the armor of God. So Ephesians 6. And this was the second song that God had me write down on a piece of paper weeks before we were to be there. And I was amazed that it's an old song, and you might know it, but it's not a cowboy church song, but I'm going to sing it anyway because I've been singing it this week, and it's just one of those songs you might catch on. It's kind of what Kelly talked about. I used to travel with a guy named Troy Withy. What Kelly talked about is we shouldn't walk in fear, and we should be walking in this power. So the song goes like this. It goes, shut the door, keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door.
window. Keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, when I was a baby child, shut the door. Keep out the devil. Oh, good and bad were just a game. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Many years and many trials. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Have proof to me they're not the same. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, Satan is an evil charmer. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. He's hungry for a soul to hurt. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. And without your holy armor, shut the door. Keep out the devil. He will eat you for dessert. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Shut the door. Keep out the devil. Light the candle. Everything's all right. Oh, light the candle. Everything's all right. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Shut the door. Keep the devil in the night. Jesus came to set us free. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. He will overcome our fears. Shut the door, keep the devil. And in him we have victory. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, light the candle, everything's all right. Oh, light the candle, everything's all right.
That's a song from way back. So, also, I wanted to tell you, I brought some Bibles. If you would like a what's called a cowboy Bible, it's actually a Bible that was, it's in recognition of Lane Frost, a guy that was a bull rider back in the 60s, and or 80s, excuse me. And I also brought, I don't want to look up my phone, I also brought stickers, these little two-inch stickers. They're on the table out here. They're free, and I call them my prayer stickers. If you'll stick them somewhere, remember to pray for me, because every Sunday I am someplace, just kind of someplace. And then on Tuesday nights I show up someplace, and I've done some funerals this last 4 weeks. So anyway, God's good, and I'm thankful to get to do and go the places he goes, and I would appreciate your prayers.
There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. The Ten Commandments, they tell me what to do. The 12 disciples are my road signs, and Jesus will take me safely through. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. The children of Israel use it too. They crossed the Red Sea of destruction. God was there to lead them safely through. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a roadmap. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. My last stop is heaven some sweet day.
It's interesting that I've heard that song for a long time, but it was brought back to my attention by my cousin. And it was kind of interesting how he would point that song out to me again and say, remember this song? So.
Oh, glory, oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I'm saved, I'm so glad I am. Oh, glory, oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I'm saved, I'm so glad I am. On Monday, I am happy. On Tuesday, full of joy. On Wednesday, I've got the faith the devil can't destroy. On Thursday and Friday, I'm walking in the light. Saturday, I've got the victory, and Sunday's always bright. Oh, glory, oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I'm saved, I'm so glad I am. Oh, glory, oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I'm saved, I'm so glad I am. Jesus, he fell in love with me. That's the very reason I've got the victory. I'm happy when it's raining. I'm happy when it shines. I'm happy now with Jesus. I'm happy all the time. Oh, glory, oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I am saved. I'm so glad I am. Oh, glory. Oh, glory, oh, glory to the Lamb. Hallelujah, I'm saved, I'm so glad I am.
Thank you. Kind of what Pastor was talking about a while ago here. Go up there. Y'all know what this is? It's called a capo, C-A-P-O, and it's for people that don't know enough guitar chords. That's right.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain. You've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose hope, for you're never alone. The God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. God of the day is still God of the night. You talk of faith when you're up on the mountain, but the talk comes easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, that's where faith is really put to the test. The God in the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. The God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. God of the day is still God of the night.
It's interesting, all the songs that God has brought across my path, and just like that, shut the door, keep out the devil. Another pastor and I were talking the other day, and this old song came up, and it was, this is like 40 years for me, I think. But it's an old chorus. And it goes, in Him we live and move and have our being. In Him we live and move and have our being. Make a joyful noise, sing it to the Lord, tell Him of your love. Dance before Him, make a joyful noise, tell Him of your love, tell Him of your love. Hallelujah. In Him we live and move and have our being. In Him we live and move and have our being. Make a joyful noise, sing it to the Lord, tell Him of your love, dance before Him. Make a joyful noise, sing it to the Lord, tell Him of your love. Hallelujah. In Him we live and move and have our being. In Him we live and move and have our being, and have our being. Thank you. Y'all may know this song.
Stand up. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high His royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, His army shall He lead. To live the foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey, for to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Yet be brave now, serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise to danger and strength to strength the pose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The armor of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. When duty calls or danger, we're never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his banner shall we lead, till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed. And Christ is Lord indeed.
Thank you. I've got one more song I want to share with you. And this chorus came up the other day. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. When we go in the name of Jesus, tell me who can stand before us. When we go in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. Who can tell what God will do? Who can tell his love for you? In the name of Jesus, Jesus, we have the victory. Hallelujah! In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. When we stand in the name of Jesus, tell me who can stand before us. In the name of Jesus, Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Boy, I tell you what, that fits really good. You know, I tell you what, tell me who can stand before us if we stand in the mighty name of Jesus. It's been a long time since I heard that one. That's good, though. That's good stuff. Well, I tell you what, we're going to close tonight. Did we get anybody to close tonight? I forgot. And my guys forgot. I'm not taking responsibility for that. I bailed them out long enough. Gary, who was we going to pray? You going to pray? Yeah. How about that microphone right there, though? There you go. Thank you, Lord. Well, just pray. He was supposed to get somebody. That's why I got him on the spot.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this church. We thank you for all the people that's in it. Lord, bless this church.
Yes, Father.
And lead and guide and direct us in your will, God. Take us the way that you want us to go.
Yes, Lord.
Take us home tonight. Be with us tonight. And come bring us back to church again.
Yes,
and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hey, there's some of those invite cards out there, the little ones with the rope around them. They've got the bring somebody. It tells about the online stuff. If you want one of those, grab those on the way out. The flyer for the men's ministry. Hey, listen, that deal's going to be awesome. We got a couple of great speakers. We're going to be down there at the Glory Barn. We're going to use it on the corner of our ranch where our very first place I ever preached. That's where we're going to be meeting on the night. Then we're going to camp out. We're going to hang out. We're going to have some good time. So, men, you know, take advantage of that. That's going to be hopefully a big group. Anyway, push that a little bit. Women's conference coming up in October. We got all kinds of things. I got a roping school going to come in December. So, we got lots of things coming. Have a blessed week.